My name's Paul McGreevy. I'm the sub-dean here for animal welfare at the faculty, and it's my job to introduce the chair for today's event. But first of all, I'd like to welcome members of the New South Wales Department of Primary Industries, veterinarians working at the animal welfare unit there. And also I'd like to welcome Rose Dixon and Jason and Justin Dixon, the family of our esteemed and greatly missed colleague, Dr. Robert Dixon, for whom these symposia are named. Robert was a great champion for animal welfare, and he was very good at seeing the balanced views that can emerge from people who've had your sorts of training. So I encourage you to embrace the ideas that you'll be hearing today. What I want to do is just remind you of one really important thing before we start. If you could turn off your mobile phones if you have them with you. And I'd also like to assure you that we will finish at 5 o'clock, so if you think we're going to overrun, you're wrong. We'll make sure we finish on time. Everybody's been briefed about that. What I'd like to do is introduce you to our chair for the day, Dr. Malcolm France. Now, Malcolm is extremely well qualified to chair this event because he's been teaching veterinary pathology for a number of years, and then he changed career path slightly to become the Director of Laboratory Animal Services here at the University of Sydney. That means he's had a great deal to do with decisions about the use of animals in teaching. He's acted as an advisor on the local animal welfare, the local animal ethics committee, and he's got a wealth of experience about how we make decisions regarding the use of animals in teaching veterinary science and animal science. Twice a year, he runs an induction course for researchers which features presentations from a diversity of ethical viewpoints, including animal rights advocates. So Malcolm has very kindly agreed to navigate us and the panel through this event, and he's going to take questions from the floor, and he'll explain how he'll do that any second now. So please join me in making Malcolm welcome.
Thank you very much, Paul. I couldn't tell you how many animals are used in teaching each year at the University of Sydney. What I can tell you is that since probably the 1970s, the number of those animals used for undergraduate teaching has fallen by something like 98 or 99%. That would seem like quite a substantial achievement. We can also brag this book, which was published last year by veterinarian Andrew Knight, who's a very strong advocate of using alternatives to animals in teaching as well as research, actually singles out this university's veterinary school as being, in his words, adopting a very progressive policy with respect to humane alternatives in 2000 through the elimination of all terminal surgical laboratories, implementation of a pound dog sterilisation program, and adoption of a policy allowing student conscientious objection. So that's, again, quite a big tick for this veterinary school. And in addition to that, increasingly we see studies published in the peer-reviewed literature which show that the use of alternatives to live animals in teaching is often as good as, and sometimes better, than actually using animals. So you could conclude from that there's been progress, and why are we still discussing whether we should be using animals at all? Well, of course, there is another side. The debate over the use of pound dogs in veterinary and animal science training continues in some areas. Andrew Knight, in the same book, the same paragraph, in fact, says even at the University of Sydney, students have still faced difficulties when requesting humane teaching methods more recently. In other words, alternatives to the use of animals. Some students are still finding resistance when they express a desire to use those sort of teaching methods. I find anecdotal accounts of people who are surprised that pound dogs are not used in research, in teaching at least, people outside the university teaching community. And even in this veterinary school at the University of Sydney, where there has been such progress over the last 10 or 15 years, moving away from a dependence on the use of animals in teaching, there are still no less than 15 approved protocols for using animals. Now, what do I mean by protocols? Any work involving the use of animals in teaching has to be approved by an animal ethics committee. And that block of work, that unit of study, is covered by what they call a protocol. The University of Sydney Veterinary School has 15 protocols that in some way or another are associated with the use of animals in teaching. Now, that, of course, is very broad. It doesn't mean those animals are killed. Very often they're used in procedures which are very much like what would be done in a normal husbandry situation. They're relatively non-invasive or non-invasive methods altogether. But nevertheless, the ethics committee of this, Animal Ethics Committee of this university still puts a considerable amount of time into assessing proposals to use to use animals in teaching. So we could say there's two sides to this debate. But in my experience, these things are never quite so simple. Perhaps it's easier or more accurate to think of a spectrum of views or opinions with a continuum running from one extreme to the other. But in mathematical terms, a continuum is still just one dimension. And I think the whole thing is probably more complicated than that too. And that's why I'm particularly delighted that Paul and the faculty have been able to assemble such an extraordinary group of people, all of whom have very close involvement, one way or another, with the use of animals in teaching or advocating alternatives wherever possible. Now, I'm going to go and introduce each of the panel members one by one to make it perverse. I'm going to introduce them in alphabetical order of their first name to show that it's totally random, with one exception. There will be one person I'll leave to last, who will be Professor Margaret Rose, who will be giving an overview from her experience, which I'll touch on in a moment, of the use of animals in teaching as well as in research. After Margaret's presentation, I'll invite each of the panel members up to give a short 2 or 3 minute presentation on their personal views, personal experiences. And then I'd like to open it to questions from the floor. Paul did encourage some people to submit questions in advance, and we have had a couple of those, and I think they are good questions, so I'll start off with those. But please, as you listen to each of the presentations, give it some thought and feel free. I think, as I hope to sort of imply already, this is not one side versus another. It's not a right or a wrong. It's much more complicated than that, and I think that's why a dialogue such as this, with a complexity of views, is such a valuable exercise. So to go through the panel members one by one, starting with A for Adele, we've got Adele Lloyd. Adele's a Sydney veterinary graduate. As an undergraduate, she was on the committee for what is now the University of Sydney Animal Welfare Society and was a student representative on the faculty's Animal Welfare Advisory Committee, which is a committee with both students and academic staff. She is a practicing companion animal veterinarian with a special interest in canine behaviour. She is co-founder and vice president of Australia's first veterinary-based animal ethics organisation known as Sentient, and is also vice president for the Australian Catalogue Rescue. Welcome, Adele. Next, we've got Catherine Tiplady, who, I'm pleased to say, is not a Sydney graduate, but someone from the University of Queensland. She graduated in 2008. Her final year research project investigated student preferences for the source of cadavers used in veterinary anatomy teaching, and the results were later published in the peer-reviewed journal ATLA, which is Alternatives to Laboratory Animals, which she co-authored with John Morton and Sean Lloyd. Catherine works part-time in practice and is currently undertaking a PhD on how veterinarians can support human and animal victims of violence. Next, we have Greg Cronin. Greg is a senior lecturer in animal behaviour and welfare science in the Faculty of Veterinary Science, University of Sydney, and holds a master's degree and PhD in applied animal behaviour science. His research is focused on farmed animals, especially pigs and poultry. Current research interests include investigation of the factors contributing to feather pecking in free-range hens, the development of non-confinement housing systems for sows, and the application of remote sensing technology to improve the monitoring of livestock under extensive management. We then have Max Zuber. Max is a specialist veterinary surgeon. He is an honorary associate professor in the Faculty of Veterinary Science at the University of Sydney. He has held the positions of director of the Veterinary Teaching Hospital and head of surgery. He's also been a visiting fellow at the University of Florida, president of the Australian New Zealand College of Veterinary Science, and a member of the Veterinary School's Accreditation Advisory Committee. His contributions to the veterinary profession have been recognised through the Seddon Award conferred by the New South Wales AVA and has been twice awarded Practitioner of the Year by the Australian Small Animal Veterinary Association. Next to him we have Peter Windsor. He's a Professor of Livestock Health and Production at the Camden campus of this Faculty of Veterinary Science at the University of Sydney. He's a specialist. He has specialist registration in pathobiology and is a diplomat of the European College of Small Ruminant Health Management. His preferred teaching is in the paddock. He's discussing ruminant health, production and welfare, especially at the University Farm Arthurs Lee, southwest of Sydney. Peter leads numerous research projects in Australia and Southeast Asia, addressing a range of issues, including foot and mouth disease control, ovine Yonis disease, neosporosis, genetic and neurological disease, and provision of pain relief for improved welfare during routine husbandry interventions. And I think you can see a bit of a theme emerging here of considerable expertise in areas that are highly relevant to considerations of welfare and ethics. Cy Woon is a fourth-year veterinary student, currently undertaking an intercalated research year. She also works as projects officer for the Medical Advances Without Animals MAWA Trust. Cy has been serving as president of the University of Sydney Animal Welfare Society since 2010 and is the founder and current president of the Sydney University Vets Beyond Borders student chapter. Last year, she was selected to attend the 8th World Congress on Alternatives and Animal Use in the Life Sciences in Montreal, where she presented on humane veterinary education, so highly topical. Victoria Andrews is currently studying for her veterinary degree in the Faculty of Veterinary Science, University of Sydney. She has an honours degree in marine biology and has worked in Canada as a vet nurse at a marine mammal rescue centre and at the Yukon Quest 1,000-mile sled dog race. Before commencing her veterinary studies, she worked as an environmental consultant and is now working as a vet nurse in general practice and at a referral specialist veterinary hospital. The last person I'll introduce will be the first person to actually speak to us, and that is Professor Margaret Rose. Margaret, I've known for many, many years, and I'm very pleased to welcome you as a friend and colleague. She's a conjoint professor in the Prince of Wales Clinical School and honorary professor with the Centre for Values, Ethics and the Law in Medicine at the University of Sydney. She's currently the Director of Research Governance for the South Eastern Sydney and Illawarra Shoalhaven Local Health Networks. She's had long involvement in the development and implementation of public policies in relation to the use of animals for scientific purposes, which of course includes the use of animals in teaching. And she was inaugural chair of the statutory body responsible for the New South Wales legislation which governs the use of animals in teaching and research. She continues as a member of the NHMRC's committee responsible for the revision of the legally binding code of practice that governs the use of animals in teaching and research, and has recently been invited to be a member for the Council for International Organisations of Medical Science committee that will be drafting international ethical principles for the use of animals in research. Margaret's also involved in science administration as a member of the Research Scientists Classification Committee for the New South Wales Premier's Department, and having served as a trustee of the Australian Museum from 1994 to 2002, she continues to be involved through membership of the Research and Collections Advisory Committee and the Eureka Prizes Judging Panel. And I should mention Margaret's also a graduate of the University of Sydney Veterinary School. So join me in welcoming all the panel members. I'd like to invite Margaret to begin the presentations.
Thank you very much, Malcolm, and thank you for those very warm and rather embarrassing words of welcome. It's a great pleasure and an honour for me to be here at my old alma mater, and particularly on this occasion of this symposium. Malcolm's instructions to me were to make this a sort of a casual discussion, so I've set aside having slides or anything prepared other than actually spending quite a bit of time thinking about the issues that we have before us today. And I was struggling to work through how I was going to start talking about it, and then I was talking last night to a very dear friend and colleague who did veterinary science with me back in the 1960s. And we reflected on just how different things were then as now. Not that, in fact, I'm actually being critical from today's perspective of what occurred then. It was done with the very best intentions. And certainly there was no doubt in my mind that we were very strictly made to adhere to the notion of respect for animals. But things have changed a lot in that 40-odd years. And when I reflected on what those changes are, it seemed to me that there were some very important pillars in those changes. The first and foremost, I think we have seen a significant shift in the community's attitude towards our treatment of animals. This relates not just to the use of animals in teaching or in research, but just broadly. The community, I think, generally is saying that we need to think very carefully about the ways in which we interact with animals, how we use them, for want of a better notion, and there is, I think, some interesting connotations from what we from that use of that word. And basically, I think we're entering an era where we say that if we actually use animals, we need to have a very good reason for doing so, and we really do need to explore the broader issues about what's the consequences of our actions. That, I think, applies to any issue in terms of how we interact with animals today. In line with that, I think one of one of the striking things that's happened in the last 40 years has been an increasing awareness of the ethical issues around our use of animals. I think a lot of that arose from the 70s from authors such as Peter Singer, who raised questions about the interests that animals had in terms of being not experiencing pain and distress, and the obligations that flowed onto us in terms of those kinds of interests. Was there really compelling ethical reasons why there were things that we shouldn't do? And then I think from that has been some much wider dialogue in terms of ethical views and perspectives. It seems to me that that's probably some of the most challenging things that we actually have got to deal with, because it really raises our consciousness of the kinds of things that we're doing and the potential impact on those animals. And as Malcolm was saying, those issues are complex. They are extraordinarily inconsistent in terms of the decisions that we make, and we might talk about that later on. But it is not a simple one-dimensional issue. To me, the third issue that is quite relevant to what's different in terms of animals in teaching has been this emergence of the availability of alternatives and alternative methods to answer the learning outcomes that we sought. And that has been a major development of recent years. It's a major contributor to the decrease in the numbers of animals that are used, which Malcolm mentioned. But it also, I think, has been driven very much as well by economic circumstances. But there's also another thing that I think is very important in this debate that really has underpinned and informed not only the way the community thinks about animals, but the decisions that we might make. And that's been advances in knowledge in two areas. One is in animal behaviour. If I think back in the 60s and 70s, we really didn't think about animal behaviour, understanding animal behaviour from the perspective of the animal, in terms of ways in which we could then start making judgments and assessments. You are so lucky that you're actually able to start sharing in that knowledge now as students. Some of us are catching up rapidly. But it seems to me that that has been a major fount of knowledge that's really helping us inform us about the ways in which we interact with animals and how that impacts on them. And the other area that's very important is, in fact, and this may seem absolutely alien to many of you, is the knowledge that we now have about how we identify and manage pain and distress. Do you know that before the 1970s, there was a couple of textbooks on animal anesthesia. There was virtually nothing around in terms of analgesia. And there's been an enormous burgeoning of knowledge in that area. That's particularly relevant to those who are actually involved in professions that are involved in animal care, as veterinarians, as animal scientists. But that kind of knowledge has really, I think, fueled and given us knowledge and insight to ways in which we better understand and can interact with animals and their environment. So if I look at the things that I was asked to mention specifically, animal welfare, ethics and legislation, there has been, in that last 40 years, an enormous shift. In animal welfare, we used to think, I think, about animal welfare solely in terms of the animal experiencing pain or distress. We now have a much broader knowledge and understanding of animal welfare. The concept of well-being is central to how we think about the experiences that animals should have. And what is in fact the negative is the default from that. And what's important around that is when we start thinking about animal well-being, it becomes the whole of life experiences of animals. It also relates to ways in which we understand animals having positive experiences from their living conditions. It brings on board this notion of a duty of care towards the animals that we interact with and the ways in which we interact with them. So we've actually got a far broader and wider concept of animal welfare that's evolved, particularly in the last 10 to 15 years. As I've mentioned, ethics has really become part of our discourse in terms of how we interact with animals. And what I think becomes very clear out of that discourse are two things. One is, although knowledge will actually underpin and inform our ethical decisions are value-based decisions. And it is inevitable that even within the ambit of this room, or more broadly, that there'll be a range of views as to what is right, what's wrong, what's good, what's bad. I think one of the important things for me in being involved in these issues over some years now is learning to learn from other people's points of view. And that is, to me, one of the most compelling and enriching experiences of being involved. I have to say, sometimes it's challenging, sometimes it's difficult, but that diversity of views brings a richness to how we deal with these issues that we should treasure, in my view. The other issue I think that has emerged in that period, in the period of time, is legislation. And legislation has changed most recently to the notion that we're not simply looking at prevention of cruelty, that is unacceptable, but we actually have a duty of care towards animals that embraces some of those broader issues around their living conditions, their quality of life. Now, in relation to the use of animals in research and teaching, and I'll split that up more in a minute, we actually do have specific legislation in New South Wales, which is called the Animal Research Act, and that specifically is directed towards those activities. We also have a code of practice, which is incorporated into that legislation. Importantly, in terms of bringing in that legislation and in the code, there was a recognition of the importance of diversity of views. There was a recognition of the importance that decisions as to how and if we use animals were decisions that were to be made taking on board the views of the wider community. So if we look at the question we've got before us today, would we answer it differently now to how we would have answered it when I was a student? I think in terms of why would we see the justification for using animals, the basic rationale, then my suspicion is that that hasn't changed in essence. But what has changed is how we actually make a decision to use animals and the circumstances in which we see it as acceptable. So I'd just like to go through how we actually approach those questions that we have today. And as a footnote, I'd just like to add that the first edition of the code that now informs our decisions about the use of animals in research and teaching, in fact, was the first edition came out in 1969. So we were thinking about some of these issues way back then. I mentioned there was legislation, but what's important about that legislation is the code of practice, because the code sets the standards by which we actually make decisions as to if and how we would use animals for scientific purposes. And in that ambit of scientific purposes, we think of research, we think of teaching, we also think of product testing. And we think of a range of activities that is not simply biomedical research, but it relates to veterinary activities, agricultural studies, relates to wildlife, environmental studies, and so forth. So there's that broad ambit of activities that need to come under the umbrella of the code. To me, the important thing about the code, which is now going through its eighth revision, is that it provides an ethical framework within which we can make decisions as to if and how we will use animals. It gives us a set of agreed principles, and it gives us a framework in terms of how we actually should apply those principles to make a decision as to if what we're proposing would be justified. It's also, I think, noteworthy that the most recent couple of editions of the Code have had a special section on the use of animals in teaching. And in that regard, they've actually made it very, it's made very clear that the default position in terms of the use of animals in teaching is that, in fact, we should be using alternatives wherever possible. But it also, I think, does recognise something else that's quite important. It recognises that students who are involved in animal, the use of animals in teaching, have an interest in this subject. They have an interest in terms of their capacity to actually understand and discuss the ethical issues that are involved, and that's part of what we're doing today. But they also have an interest to be able to be accommodated in terms of whether they have an objection to how that occurs. So if we actually look at what the Code says in a general principle, it says that, in fact, we shouldn't be using animals in research or teaching unless it's justified. And that justification is based on the evidence that, in fact, there is benefit, there is worth, predicted benefit in terms of what's being proposed, and that in fact, there is not any way in which we actually can meet the goals that we've set without using animals. If the answer to that is that, in fact, yes, and there is an acceptable reason for using animals, or case made to using animals, then we still need to consider whether the numbers of animals involved and what's the impact. What I'm referring to there is the short script for the three R's: replacement, reduction, refinement. Importantly, though, when we've actually got that evidence together, we still have to make a decision as to whether there is a case made to use animals. And that decision is an ethical decision. Now, what I'd just like to do quickly is just highlight that there are some important differences between research and teaching. When we approach this question in terms of the Code generally, I think there is a notion that is very much focused on research. Interestingly, I did a Google over the weekend just to see how much there was there around the use of animals in teaching, and almost everyone was, in fact, linked to research and teaching. And although it's sort of, I think, quite clear what the pathway is in terms of looking at what could be the justification for research in terms of background justification for the merits of what's proposed, it seems to me it's not quite that clear in terms of when we look at it for teaching. Some years ago, that was actually recognised by the Animal Research Review Panel, and we actually had a series of workshops looking at specifically the issues around the use of animals in teaching. And I think some of the outcomes of those workshops were really quite useful. Because what it actually recognised was, in fact, there was first and foremost a community expectation that if we use animals in teaching, that we do so in a way that is humane, and we do so only if it's necessary. The other thing that really struck me out of those discussions, and we had a number of people from an education background that were involved in those discussions, was that in terms of learning outcomes, we really need to have a good, strong link between specific learning outcomes and the activities that were proposed. And that seems to me starting to put some rigour behind the decisions and justification for considering the use of animals in teaching. The other thing that I also didn't appreciate, and I think I start to appreciate then, was that people learn in different ways, and different kinds of learning experiences are relevant to different people in terms of how they actually approach a question. So there may be a need to start thinking about some of the flexibility in terms of how we actually approach teaching and teaching methods and what we're doing. But leaving all that else aside, I think the other clear message to me in that was that, in fact, people learnt best when, in fact, what they were learning was relevant to the experiences they needed. And that brings me to the issue about students of veterinary medicine and animal sciences. Because there, the level and type of skills and learning that you need is really quite relevant. The purpose here would seem to me to be clearly the development and skills and knowledge which are relevant to your professional aspirations. And it seems to me inexplicable that you will actually not be involved with animals in some ways as part of gaining that skills and knowledge. However, how you do that and the settings in which you do that are really quite important to be thought through. What we do when we apply even with our skills and knowledge as a professional is we bring on board a matrix of knowledge and experiences that will actually inform what we're doing. And that is true for whether we might be sort of looking at the behaviour of an animal. Animal behaviour and understanding that what is actually the motivations of behaviour, what it means, how we interpret it, is really important for us to actually start understanding animal well-being. We then apply it to ways in which we learn to better handle and restrain animals. Other example is, in fact, we see animals who are ill or they're showing some signs of illness or sickness. We need to actually have the understanding knowledge of what we're seeing might mean and what the mechanisms might be. So that, in fact, if we're looking at that interaction of us with animals in terms of the skills and knowledge that we acquire as a professional, there is, in fact, quite a broad matrix that comes together. In terms of the skills that we actually seek to learn, what is really important is also to recognise they're not technical skills in isolation. They are skills which are underpinned by knowledge, a knowledge which is specific to the circumstances. So with that in mind, what do we actually need to see in terms of how we might be making some decisions about the justification for the use of animals in teaching? In essence, what we need to look at are what are the benefits and the potential benefits in terms of learning outcomes. But we also may need to just bear in mind what might the costs be. Those costs clearly might relate to the impact on the animals, but we shouldn't forget that there may be a cost if we actually don't acquire the knowledge or the skills that we need to actually fulfil something that we wish to as a professional. We need to apply rigorously the principles of can we actually acquire the skills and knowledge we need without the use of animals? The use of alternatives is, in fact, a rich field now that is enormously helpful to all of us. There may be also alternative ways in which we actually approach to do it that may involve the use of live animals, but in a settings which, in fact, are more humane and more appropriate. So it would seem to me that we have before us a number of options to actually answer the challenges of what we need. I think it's also important, though, in that, to recognise that there are a number of interested parties. Clearly, the primary interested party is the animals involved. But the other interested parties in those decisions are the institutions that are offering the courses, the teachers that are involved, the students themselves, and the wider community. And as we actually seek to make a decision about this, though all those interests need to be taken on board. And we actually seek to do that in terms of two ways. The responsibilities for making a decision about use of animals rests with the teacher, the student, and the institution. And the community needs to be satisfied that in making that decision, the kinds of principles that they expect, that's conducted humanely and being necessary, are being met. And the instrument that we have put in place to do that is called the Animal Ethics Committee. And the membership of that committee is consciously and deliberately a diverse membership, a membership that includes researchers and teachers, but also includes members of the community and members and people from animal welfare organisations, as well as veterinarians. This is not meant to be a rubber stamp committee. It is meant to be a committee that looks at the complexities of these issues and actually debates them and works through what we're doing. The other issue about responsibilities in terms of the code, I think, is what is the responsibility of professional? And that's something I think that's worthy to be thought about. As a student seeking a professional career, one has a responsibility to make sure that you have the skills and the knowledge to undertake the role that you're choosing to play when you become graduate. That also is the responsibility of the institution to give an assurance that you actually have those skills and competency. Those issues, I think, are really important and need to be reflected upon. on part of both, or both those parties, the researchers, the students and the institution. And they are important issues in terms of our accountability to the wider community. And that accountability is really relating to high standards of professional competence. So if we look at the issues, to me it's very much a work in progress. And to me it will be a continuing work in progress. Because I do not see in the future, very soon anyway, that we will actually come to a consensus in terms of the ethical status of animals. We will have a diversity of views, which I think are really important to be brought into that discussion about the decisions as to if and how we're going to use animals. For me, that diversity of views, has been the lifeblood for me in terms of being involved in these issues, because it actually keeps you focused and challenges you to think through where are you going, why is this important. Other and often confronting views, I think, are ones that I welcome, as difficult as sometimes that might be. But I think the other thing I believe very strongly is that diversity of views really enhances the outcomes that we achieve. My final point is, in fact, our ambitions as professionals. I started by saying that, in fact, a lot of the issues that we're confronting are ones that are confronted by the wider community in the range of issues in terms of how we interact with animals and we use them. And it seems to me we have a particular role as professionals in terms of providing leadership in terms of how the community can actually address these issues. And I'll leave you with those thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret, very much for those reflections on the complex factors that have brought us where we are today and where we might be heading in the future. Our next speaker, Adele Lloyd, if you'd like to come up. Thank you.
I would like to read an abbreviated version of Sentient, the Veterinary Institute for Animal Ethics, position statement on the use of animals in research and teaching. We believe that animals selected for use in research and teaching are above all sentient beings. Therefore, they must be treated as such, than being merely regarded as a resource for teaching or as tools for data collection. Sentient promotes ethical reflection by all researchers and educators regarding the potential use of animals in their work. We subscribe to the 3R principles with replacement as the first option. The onus should be on academics to provide proof that animals can't be replaced as research or teaching subjects due to the lack of viable alternatives. They should also provide evidence that if animals are used, they will not be subject to pain or distress. Sentient also promotes an ongoing commitment to the highest standard of care for animals used in research and teaching. We oppose any procedures that cause pain, suffering, distress, lasting physiological harm or behavioural disturbance, or death as an endpoint. Ethical use of animals mandates that researchers and educators acknowledge and protect 5 freedoms. Several responsibilities arise from this, but of utmost importance is the use of analgesia and or anaesthesia to prevent pain and suffering. Sentient believes that only qualified Australian registered veterinarians should perform anaesthesia, surgery or other invasive procedures on an animal, and they must be qualified and adept at performing these procedures on the animal species in question. Allowance is made for veterinary students to perform surgical and anaesthetic procedures only under the constant, direct and personal supervision of a qualified Australian registered veterinarian. Assessments of the well-being of animals used in research and teaching must consider the cumulative impact of their experiences. Animals should be used in research and teaching projects for a limited period, and investigators or educators must ensure that after their use, such animals are not subjected to further research and are provided with appropriate housing, husbandry and rehoming avenues. Sentient recommends that all research and teaching using animals be conducted in accordance with the Australian Code of Practice for the care and use of animals for scientific purposes, and that personnel working with animals must have ready access to a conscientious objection policy and to complaints procedures. Sentient also maintains that research and teaching involving the use of animals be subjected to annual scrutiny by an external auditing system rather than relying exclusively on self-regulation, as this would provide the highest level of transparency and increase accountability. Thank you.
Thanks, Adele. I think that very clearly articulated the position of Sentient, which I see as a very interesting and important development in the ethical consideration of the use of animals, not just in teaching, but in other areas too. Our next speaker is Catherine. That's right. Forgetting my alphabet. Catherine Tiplady.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you for inviting me down here, Paul. I am a UQ graduate from 2008, so I'll just give you a quick background of what the situation was there with the use of animals. So started in 2004, and you begin 3 weeks into the course with a pound dog dissection class. So we're told in that class that these dogs are going to die anyway, whether we use them or not, and we dissect them, and then they were thrown away. There were all sorts of different breeds that you'd find in the pound, and pretty much all very healthy looking dogs. Later in that year, we moved on to greyhounds that were preserved and frozen, and we'd reuse them in groups of four or five students. And veterinary anatomy is taught in the first and second years of the course. Then you move into postmortems and then live animals, and we did terminal surgery pracs in fourth and fifth year, and a terminal resuscitation prac, and other terminal procedures such as catheterizing dogs and getting blood from them, x-rays and ultrasounds. Okay, so in the fifth year of the course, I decided, as part of my research elective I was doing, to do a survey of vet students to see what their preferences would have been if they, So I surveyed the first year students before and after their dog dissection class, the first ever one, and third year students and fifth years to ask what source of cadaver they would have preferred. So pound dog slash x-racing greyhound as one option, donated or ethically sourced cadavers. I didn't call them ethically sourced, I called them donated, and defined that as a dog which has been euthanized for medical reasons and donated by the owner for teaching purposes, or whether the students had no preference. So a substantial amount of students in all years said they had no preference at all, so between about 30 and 48% they didn't mind. But interestingly, the first years who had never dissected a dog, there was about 48% preferred the idea of a donated dog cadaver. After their first dissection prac and the introductory speech on, you know, they're going to die anyway, there was less, and that dropped down to about 22% in the fifth years. So apart from the first years, that was longitudinal to look at how they changed over just in a few weeks. There were different cohorts, so different groups, but it still is interesting and really raises the issue is whether students are becoming desensitized as they progress through the vet course into the euthanasia of healthy animals for teaching purposes. So that's basically what I did my research project in, and welcome any questions on that when there's the question time. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. And I think through your survey, you showed how, perhaps for the first time ever, veterinarians and veterinary students were being questioned about things that previous generations of students would have totally taken for granted. And I think that links into what Margaret was saying, how we're really starting to look at these things differently. Okay, next come up, and Greg Cronin, thank you.
Thanks, Malcolm. Okay, I think I'm unique on this panel because I'm not a vet. So it's a little bit of a different perspective. But as a teacher involved in training future animal scientists, I see it is my role to inform students on the responsible use of animals while also ensuring students are competent in their use of animals. Of course, I don't undertake this task alone. I'm part of a team of teachers in this faculty that strives to see our students achieve the university and the animal veterinary bioscience graduate attributes. Enabling student learning through hands-on interaction with animals relevant to a career in animal science is therefore very important from my perspective. A starting point in the learning experience of animal science students is how to handle animals, and Professor Rose has nicely mentioned that earlier. This handling provides the opportunity to build on other practical skills, for example, recognising behavioural change in the animal, which would help detect health or welfare problems. By understanding what normal behaviour looks like, it is possible to identify non-normal behaviour and hence detect problems. But when and how do students learn this if they can't interact with animals? In my opinion, hands-on interaction with animals is probably the best teaching method for most students to learn about the animals used by humans. Hands-on interaction provides a multi-dimensional information about the animal which can't really be learned from books or even videos at times. Hands-on interaction enables students to experience the animal and its responses in three dimensions. So visually in three dimensions is superior than on a video screen or out of a book. But also to find information or to learn about the tactile nature of the animal, its audible signals and the olfactory things that tell you something when it's normal compared to non-normal. So this helps the student to learn and differentiate between normal and non-normal responses. So the importance of using animals in teaching in the VBS degree was recently reinforced to me when I surveyed my students. Almost 98% of the students indicated a strong preference for hands-on involvement with animals in teaching. Only one of 84 Year 3 students surveyed indicated that it was not appropriate to involve the use of animals. From my survey also, it was indicated to me that 60% of my third year students have a career goal to be involved in animal research. The Animal Veterinary Bioscience course provides students with a pathway to achieve this goal, including the experience of animal research via their honours project in year four and then possible postgraduate activities following graduation. In conclusion, therefore, I think that the use of animals is an essential component in teaching animal science. Clearly, how we are permitted to use animals is dictated by a number of factors, and that's been beautifully described by Professor Rose. Nevertheless, we shouldn't lose sight of what is relevant for developing knowledge and competencies sought by employers of our animal science graduates. Thank you, Mel.
Thanks very much, Greg. Focusing on the vocational importance of this and the welfare benefits of ensuring students are trained using the best possible methods that involve a 3D and experience and at least four of the five senses, I would also add to that. Okay, our next speaker, Max Zuber, if you'd like to come up, Max, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Malcolm, and good afternoon. My role at the university and I guess outside it also is to be involved in training students for surgery. I look upon surgery as a practical entity that requires physical skills but also a mental aptitude to apply these skills in a multitude of different situations. Physical skills can be taught by a variety of repetitive exercises, but correct application of these skills in a rapidly changing environment involving a biological system in our patients is a much more challenging problem to overcome. Society today and the veterinary profession itself expects that on the day of graduation, our students are able to competently and safely spay a female dog. If I said if I used instead of spay, if I said that they had to do a bilateral salpingo oophorectomy and hysterectomy, I wonder if the level of expectation of our graduates' performance may be somewhat altered. Since my time as an undergraduate, and I go back to the same era as Margaret, we have slowly but progressively moved away from using live animal surgery teaching for students. And in this time, there has been a growing criticism from employers in the profession on the surgical competence and confidence, and I would stress confidence, of our graduates. I'm pleased to say, though, that in the last few years, with some new initiatives that we have taken, that this criticism has become more muted. Yes, we do still use cadavers in our surgery teaching. These are accessed from sources that sign a document to indicate we have had no influence on the decision to euthanise, the technique used, the timing of the euthanasia, and that they gain no reward from the provision of these animals for the purposes of teaching our students. Our final year students act as assistants to our surgery staff in a great variety of surgical procedures. For over 10 years now, 10 or 12 years, we've had an arrangement with the Council Pound for final year students to desex groups of animals that then go on to be rehomed. We have, together with the medical school and the CSIRO, some time ago now, explored the potential to develop a virtual reality dog spay model. Unfortunately, the millions of dollars that was going to be involved in computer programming to achieve this, once the CSIRO computer boffins started to look at the complexities of manipulations that were involved in a dog spay, just blew us out of the water. At a sort of much lower level of endeavour, we have recently produced a whole series of videos for student use on all of our surgery practical classes. These are made available to the students before the classes, but also are projected during the classes to add to the experience while they are undertaking their surgery practical work. We have developed an online assessment tool for students to track their surgery skill developments and also the number of procedures that they do become involved with. We have more recently entered into agreements with the RSPCA to allow us to take groups of students to their hospital and undertake desexing operations where they're under the direct supervision of university staff members. We have more recently moved on from here to a program that we have great hope for. This is a CAUSE program in association with the RSPCA and local council, where disadvantaged members of our society can bring their animals forward to have them desexed by, in this instance, our fourth year students up at Camden. And we're hoping that this will in fact start within the next 2 weeks, this whole program. I'm pleased to also report that we've actually had a publication in the Journal of Veterinary Education in fact, Friday of last week. It has come out, and it is a report on our efforts to decrease the use of animals, including things such as a model. And I guess that's one of the aspects of things that were featured in this article, the development of this model of a dog abdomen to enable students to desex a dog in a real and meaningful way. We estimate this provides about 85% of the real feel of dealing with an abdomen and desexing a dog. There's a replaceable genital tract that can be taken out and a new one put in for the next student to come along. So one of my questions that I would like to pose for the audience today is perhaps an ethical dilemma that I face here in some ways. Should I make an effort to keep intact our current combination of techniques that we're using leading to closely supervised desexing surgery on shelter animals? Or should we just let our students interact with models, the we equivalent, etc., and let them experiment as they are legally able to do on their first day after graduation of doing their first 6 to 12 animals where they're desexing them for paying clients. Thank you.
Thank you, Max. I think you've shown great responsiveness and scope for adaptation, while at the same time emphasising the importance of not underestimating the complexity of the dynamic systems people are dealing with in situations such as surgery. I would have learnt the order by now. Peter Windsor, thank you.
Thanks, Malcolm, and afternoon all. What happened here? There we go. We've been reflecting a little bit about the way things used to be, and I thought it was appropriate to join in that. I came a little bit after Max and Margaret, mid-70s, and there were certainly some of the practices back then were perhaps a little extreme. They certainly... They created some concerns in our year, some of the physiology experiments with decerebrates and the repeated surgeries that we had without pain management, and the induction of clostridial diseases in livestock. Now, most of that stuff now is available for a video, fortunately, from that era, so we can teach it without having to subject the animals to what we thought were quite cruel. The faculty was very responsive, and we would not consider ourselves conscientious objectors. We just raised the issues and things have moved on. However, from the other point of view, is that I've had a lot of work in Southeast Asia with people, non-veterinarians and veterinarians, working with real diseases like FMD, and I can remember an incident where we were about to open a new abattoir in the Philippines that the Japanese had funded. And I went down to the yards to inspect the pigs, and they're all piled in on top of each other and in a trough, shivering, with nice vesicles on their nose. And I said to the veterinarian in charge, who was a very senior veterinarian, from, "Everything all right here?" He said, "Yes, everything's all right here." "Yes. Is there anything wrong with the pigs?" "No, nothing wrong with the pigs." "Did you get in and inspect them?" No. Standard practice in many parts of the world of people who haven't had the kind of hands-on experience that we can give you here with our animals is to do a cursory examination. And on that particular case, if we hadn't diagnosed the disease, this disease would have spread throughout the country very quickly because they had FMD. So what I'm suggesting here is that we, before we throw, well, what I'm going to just briefly mention a few points that around these sort of incidences that I've observed. I actually think that we need to use animals in teaching it as an essential requirement because we need students with high-level skills that come from repeated manipulations in a variety of contexts with clinical, surgical, pathological, epidemiological skills we need for our profession, understanding population contexts. We observe changing attitudes, which I've just described over time, and of course, community expectations are always changing, but some will argue with good reason that more manipulative or surgical time the better, and others will argue for animal replacements by videos and models, as we've heard today from others. But always I think we have to be careful of extremist views. I mean, we often talk about the danger of men in shiny suits, well, as the danger of the zealot issue too. We need to be a little bit careful that we don't create too big a compromise. Promotion of extremist views threatens survival of society, in fact. You know, no animals to be used for food. How can we can't? That's a particular outlier point of view, in my opinion, and others would share that. Some of the key issues that objections are mostly about what's harmful. The other issue is the demographic changes. In my year, most people came from a rural background, whereas that's almost a rarity these days. And so handling of live animals, particularly farm animals, prior to entry to the degree is quite unusual. But you need to understand animal husbandry and farm management practices as a veterinarian or an animal scientist working with livestock. And livestock are a particular issue because, as Margaret mentioned, our duty of care, we're talking about estimated 30 billion animals used for food by 2020. And by 2050, 9.5 billion people, many will be... and many of the animals that feed that population are currently in the care of the 1.4 billion people who are living below the poverty line as poor holders. Our job as vets and animal scientists is to encourage those people to use appropriate welfare practice. We're the champions of animal welfare. So what are our solutions to this dilemma? Well, in use of animals for teaching? Well, it's about minimising harm. It's not about not using animals. In fact, I advocate we should be increasing the number of animals for teaching and decreasing the time each animal is subjected to veterinary interventions, i.e. sharing the burden. And we can do this. We have Arthursley available to us. We have 12,000, 14,000 sheep. Each sheep will get bled once. They'll only see a veterinary student once. They have great memory for faces, so if you hurt them, they'll get back at you next time they come in. Fortunately, that's never happened. Our students only see one sheep in their life. We should promote animal welfare sensitive practices in the use of teaching to ensure minimal harm. So if euthanasia is an endpoint, then focus on the use of moribund animals or economically unsound animals that aren't able to produce a lamb or a calf or whatever from the next year. So that's a standard practice for those to be culled and sent to the abattoir. Thirdly, increasing teaching using alternative animal techniques such as videos and models and things, as we've heard, is fine. Finally, my last point is promote widely that we use animals in a welfare responsible manner in the veterinary school. And ask the question always when you're seeing animal used, not even necessarily about the five freedoms, but a simpler context that they're asking in the UK now. Is that animal leading a life not worth living, or a life worth living, or a good life? And we should be advocating that all our animals we use have a good life. Quite simple. We just don't harm them, or we minimise it if we do any procedures that does produce harm. Thanks.
Thank you, Peter, for touching on the broader perspective with some international considerations, as well as the urbanisation of society. Interesting points. Sigwin, thank you.
Hi. As mentioned in the introduction, I attended the 8th World Congress on Alternatives in Animal Use in the Life Sciences, and I actually presented a paper that I wrote on this very topic. It was titled "A Veterinary Student's Perspective on Educational Animal Use and the Potential for Humane Alternatives." And interestingly, it was actually conducting research for this paper that exposed me to the wealth of alternatives and innovations that are currently happening in the area of veterinary science, so ethically superior and also more effective ways of teaching veterinary science, which don't necessarily require the use of animals. Within my paper, I conducted a survey, and it was actually based on Dr. Tiplady's survey that was under review at the time, and I surveyed years 1 to 5 of the veterinary students here at the University of Sydney, and it was, as well as Catherine's, it was on cadaver preferences, and it was really interesting to see the range of responses I obtained, because I specifically asked students to write the reasons for their choice of cadavers. And I don't think I'll have sufficient time to go into the details about the responses I obtained in my subsequent discussion, but it was evident that a lot of students had, no preference for cadaver sources, and also there was largely uninformed assumptions regarding the issues surrounding the sourcing of cadavers. And as I mentioned, prior to having done a substantial amount of research for this paper and subsequent presentation, I was also unaware of some of the ethical issues concerning cadaver sources. So I hope that you'll be able to read more, especially on like Catherine's paper, which was recently published, and also read more Dr. Andrew Knight's works. So as Malcolm introduced before, he published a book last year, The Cost of Benefits of Animal Experiments, and he was a veterinary student who conscientiously objected to the invasive use of animals while he was at his veterinary school, and as a result they actually introduced the conscientious objection policy, which then spread to other veterinary schools nationally and internationally. So yes, what else do I want to... Yes, there's probably going to be, I hope, a lot of issues and questions are raised throughout the discussion because, as mentioned, I won't be able to discuss everything here. But, I guess I should also bring up that there's a wealth of literature, as mentioned, regarding the superiority of alternatives which are available. And unfortunately, a lot of us just aren't aware of the presence of them and their superiority in regards to teaching efficacy. So we'll hopefully be able to mention those. And also, I was able to promote Professor Zuber's innovations, which were happening at the faculty at the time, such as the ovariohysterectomy model, which was of interest internationally. So when I was doing the presentation, a lot of researchers and other veterinarians and academics were surprised and excited to see such an innovative model being produced here at the faculty. So in conclusion, I'll just say that I hope you all try and question as much as you can, and I hope that this is a very fruitful discussion and that you learn a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Sai. Again, somebody who's done research into the subject, come up with some interesting findings, and I think also discovered the complexity and depth of the issues. Finally, Victoria, if you'd like to come forward. Thank you.
Hi, thanks for coming, everyone. So I'm here to give, I guess, another student's perspective. I'm currently a fourth year vet student. And I suppose my opinion on this subject is that, you know, so many pound animals are euthanized every year. And I sort of think if, you know, it's such a waste for these animals to die, so why not learn from them? And so I've got a few examples. So last year, as a third year student, we were doing a practical and we were learning how to do skin sampling on a stuffed animal. And so I don't need to tell you how much sort of we gained out of that. And then just last week in fourth year, we were able to do this on pound dog cadavers. And it was just so worthwhile actually doing it on an animal. And now I feel a lot more confident than when I am out in practice and, you know, it's an itchy fluffy white dog comes in, I feel that I can actually, you know, sample the skin as opposed to just having done it on a stuffed toy. And this also is the same for doing spays and castrations, because I would hate to be going out into practice and charging people like good money when I don't feel very confident in doing it, whereas if I have had the chance to, you know, do some on cadavers and... also, in fourth year, we now get to, the CAUSE program that was mentioned, where sort of lower socioeconomic families get to come in and we get to spay and neuter their dogs. And also, I would definitely rather have done some spays on cadavers before I'm unleashed onto someone's beloved dog. So I guess we also need to think that when we do get the chance to use these animals, it's a privilege and not a right, and we do need to respect these animals and try to gain the most out of that we can out of a sad situation. So thank you.
Thanks very much, Victoria, for your reflecting on your own personal experiences. You used the word confidence again, which had been raised by Max in his presentation, so some recurring themes from that particular point of view. Okay, well, it's now, unfortunately, we've only got 15 minutes for questions, so we're going to have to be a bit selective. I think, to be fair, I would like to begin A couple of students did submit questions in advance in response to a request to do so. And is Jamie Wheelhouse here? Would you? Now, I'm going to have to, if you want to ask a question, I'm going to have to repeat it so it's in fact, I might read it out because I've got it already. Because the camera and the tape won't pick up a question coming from the audience. Your main question was, I would like to know if there was evidence to suggest that if universities were not using cadavers, would there be a decrease in the number of dogs or horses euthanized? So is there a member of the panel who'd like to respond to that? I'll read the question again. I would like to know if there is evidence to suggest that if universities were not using cadavers, would there be a decrease in the number of dogs and horses euthanized? Are we actually driving the decision to euthanize dogs or horses in some situations? Margaret. I'll pass that.
I think I'll just perhaps make some comments about that. This was an issue some years ago which was under consideration by the state government, and there was a committee that was convened by the then minister, of which I was a member, that looked at some of the broad issues around the pound source of animals. I really think that unfortunately there isn't the link there. I think there is very clearly we have a significant social problem about abandoned animal pets and cats and dogs and horses. And to me, that is really a much broader social issue. Whether or not that is in any way driving the use of those animals in research and teaching, and whether there's any link between there, I must say we found absolutely no evidence of it.
Thanks, Margaret. So I'd also like to respond to that same question.
Yes. So in regards to the use of pound dogs, I wanted to bring up the alternative source of ethically sourced cadavers, which can be obtained from donated dogs. So currently we do use these in our pathology practicals, but I completely forgot to mention before that this is, even though it's still using animals, it's an ethical alternative, and it's currently being utilised by veterinary schools across the world. So Tufts University, Cumming School of Medicine, have been using ethically sourced cadavers for more than a decade now, and they've shown that this has been logistically feasible. It has increased the skill attributes of their students, and it's just been very successful. It's a very well-known and renowned veterinary school, and they're producing competent graduates. So incorporating a body donation program is also relevant, and it addresses the pound dog issue as well.
Could I just follow with... Okay, then, sure.
I understand, Simon, you're saying that there is an ethical alternative to cadavers, but I'm failing to get to hear what is unethical about using pound cadavers.
Thank you. Okay, so I'll just repeat the question. It's the definition of what constitutes an ethical cadaver. What is unethical about using cadavers sourced from council pounds?
Okay. Sorry, that's a really great question. So throughout the literature, what constantly emerges is the term ethically sourced cadaver, and so the definition of that is a cadaver that has died naturally or been euthanized for medical reasons, or has been killed in an accident of some kind. So that's the difference between something that's a pound dog and a greyhound. So the reason that those sources might not be considered ethical is because they are in some way byproducts of those industries. So that's the primary reason. And like other reasons which also emerge for the preference to use donated cadavers, which are more ethical, are because of the associated desensitization. And so that was very well described in Catherine's study that she did. And it was also evident in the survey that I conducted. So sorry, I should probably explain that quickly, a bit more desensitization.
I think we might just...
Sorry.
We can certainly, that's a very important point, the issue of desensitisation, because that's come up in a couple of presentations. I would like to just ask Carol Doughty if she's here. Carol? I'll read Carol's question anyway, because I think it's quite a relevant one. What would be the best process for vet students, and this could also apply to animal science students, to experience and learn safe handling of a fractious and stressed animal without compromising the animal's welfare? So a member of the panel who'd like to consider that, what would be the best process for students to gain experience in handling stressed and fractious animals without compromising the animal's welfare? I wonder, maybe, Catherine, would you like to comment on that?
That sounds like a really... Can you hear me? Oh, it sounds like a really good question, and I would think that maybe watching videotaped footage of an expert in that species handling them would be a really good start, and then probably going along with them to, you know, work alongside them. I think you'd also have to really limit the number of people handling that animal or even being present. So say you've got a stressed feral or semi-feral cat you're trying to handle, you don't want 11, 12 students in there with, you know, leather gloves on or blankets and everyone getting freaked out and scratched. So I would think maybe videotape footage would be a good start, and then everyone can, you know, look at the right way it should be done.
Thanks, Catherine. I'd like to invite two other panel members to speak on that. Peter, would you like to comment on it? Adele first. Yeah.
Thank you. Having a special interest in canine behaviour and working out in practice with small animals, I do see a lot of vets and nurses trying to restrain fractious animals, whether it's dogs or cats. I feel cats are worse because they seem to have five areas of weapons, whereas dogs are mainly just from the mouth. But on the canine side of things, a lot of people just think all they need to do is restrain them, jab the needle in or whatever they need to do, and that's it. But the problem there is that the next time the dog remembers, and it just makes it harder and harder. So I definitely agree with Catherine. Having videos of behavioural situations like that with people that they know what they're doing with these behavioural issues, because even though as vets we do learn some behavioural issues with dogs and cats, that's my area, we don't really go into the fact of what you do if you've got a feral cat. You've got to do what you need to do with them, but how do you do it without ending up in hospital? So definitely starting off with videos is a good way to go.
Okay.
Well, you're talking about probably the most dangerous species that exists. My my own experience with a cat that stole my fish the night before my surgery exam, and I grabbed its tail as it took off across the fence, was that I ended up with Pasteurella multicida infection in my hand as it bit me. But anyway, I subsequently learned from that to concentrate on much more interesting animals like cattle. I thought I should bring it to your attention that one of the big concerns that we always had was that we were, for many years coming here, the students were only really getting exposed to dairy cows, which are really, like the tamest of moggies. And so we put a lot of money into investing in good quality cattle yards at Arthur's Lee so that students would be able to be exposed to beef cattle, because beef cattle are not trained to come into the quietly and get milked twice a day like our dairy cows. And they are fractious animals, and they quite often try to damage students. So but vets need to know how to deal with them safely, and you need to learn instinctively how to protect yourself from working in yards from cattle, beef cattle, and not get in the way of them and not treat them like pets when they get their head in the crush so that they smash your hand up when you go to pat them and things like that. So just bringing it back to the livestock area, learning about quality equipment, how to use it properly, and how to protect yourself as an OH&S issue, as a veterinarian, is an absolute critical part of your teaching. It's the Australian Cattle Vets recently had an email discussion about injuries that vets have acquired from dealing with cattle, and it absolutely blows you away. Everybody's got multiple lesions, including myself, several, from working with cattle, because the facilities that you have to work with quite often are substandard. So just the issue of, I don't know how I got to that, but I think it's somehow related to the fact that you can't teach that via video.
Thanks, Peter. Questions from the floor? Yes.
Do we ever differentiate between the use of animals in teaching animal handling and the use of animals in, say, surgical practices and more invasive things.
Okay, so... Well, I think we're discussing a lot, but the question is that there are different, probably broadly two scenarios in which we might use animals. One is in animal handling, the other is in actually acquiring manual skills for therapeutic procedures. I suppose how much overlap is there between those two areas, animal handling versus specific procedures? Max, would you like to comment on that as a companion animal practitioner particularly?
I was just thinking about the feral cat syndrome and... As someone who has a special interest in hypothyroid cats, I often say that it's really an occupational hazard to actually take these cats on. So I would love one of those videos that told me how to cope with every one of those cats, because I've been doing this for 40 years now and I still get caught out sometimes. In terms of the differential, I suppose that I think my answer is, I've still to come up with a really good way of teaching students to be competent surgeons without them doing surgery, right? I haven't seen that yet, okay? But I think it is possible to train people to observe behavioural sort of characteristics that animals might be displaying, to understand how they might react and so forth. So I think there are elements of being able to do that that don't involve threatening physical harm to the patient while you're taking that on. I don't think that undergraduate students should be forced into a situation of having to deal with a feral cat. They are very well armed. But there may be circumstances where it's going to happen one day and you're stuck with this and you have to know the basic principles of how to manage that situation that you're in.
Thanks very much, Max. I really apologise. I think I've let time slip away a little bit. I think we've got time for one more question. What I'm going to propose, I know some people have commitments, they need to leave at 5 o'clock, but Paul, with your permission, I think I could invite the rest of you who want to stay and those members of the panel who are able to stay for a few more minutes, and we can continue the discussion with maybe about a 2-minute break. We'll have one more question, then a 2-minute break for anybody who needs to leave, and those who are able to remain behind, we continue it for perhaps another 15 minutes or so. So it's one more really burning question. Ah, yes. Rachel.
And it's more the question of, are hound dogs reproducing them? What I noticed there was basically they are a constant renewable resource. Dogs are a biological system, and in the Hampertown area, I was involved in euthanizing hound dogs, you know, for several years. And it's a gut-wrenching process to go week after week after week and think, will I ever get to the bottom of this pile? But they are a constantly renewable resource, and part of me at least appreciated that I felt like I was putting them down for no valuable reason except that people were irresponsible owners and dogs always in bloody pound. But as a veterinary surgeon, I did appreciate the fact that somebody could benefit from them because they were of no other benefit to society in a lot of ways.
Okay, so thank you very much. So the question again is that we have social factors that lead to pretty much a constant supply of pound dogs, which can be used in teaching, yet there is an ethical opposition in some cases against that. Who would like to comment on that? Who's Sai? Okay.
Sorry. Okay. So a lot of students actually mentioned that in their survey responses as their reason for choosing pound dogs as their cadaver preference. As mentioned. The issues behind that and the reason why other veterinary schools have decided to use alternatives or ethical alternatives is because that the alternative of ethically sourced cadavers is logistically feasible, as mentioned. It has time-saving costs. It's not more difficult to achieve. And also alternatives such as computer simulations and other things can enable students to develop superior technical skills. So I just briefly mentioned in my paper that like Animal Welfare League of Queensland, for instance, has implemented the Getting to Zero policy, which is working towards like lessening the euthanasia of healthy dogs. And they've managed to obtain a rehome and reclaim rate of over 90%. So, you know, initiatives such as that can help kind of like support the alternative.
Thanks. I just wondering, Victoria, would you like to say anything on that point, just an ethical view on the use of pound dogs?
Just a point on the alternative use, that is a great idea, but the fact of the matter is there's still pound dogs, you know, they're still being euthanized, so if we can learn from it, it just doesn't seem like as much of a waste. So until there is still no dogs in pounds, then, you know, they're not, like, alternatives will be a great, well, they're always going to be great, but until there is no dogs in pounds, we may as well learn from them.
Okay.
Can I just say, perhaps, just to let you know that historically we have tried to source dogs from veterinarians that had been euthanized for pathology classes and for surgery classes. There were a variety of, and this probably, my memory's fading a little bit on it now, it was probably late 80s, early 90s, something like that. The logistics of doing this and making them suitable samples for instance, surgery teaching was very difficult. There was the issue of getting permission from their owners, often at a very difficult emotional time for them. We felt it was essential that they gave permission in writing for their dogs to be donated. And that, as I said, that was an emotionally difficult time for them. The vets didn't want to put them through it. Then there was the issue of their storage and delivery to the faculty, and it sort of went on and on. And I think, I can't remember now, it probably ran for about 18 months or so, and eventually failed through the problems that were arising with it and the lack of success in the supply. Mind you, you know, we've got to think about how many animals we need to run a practical class, sometimes two, and the numbers of students that are going through. And in those days, there were probably 2/3 the class numbers, perhaps, that we have now, that we had to accommodate during those classes. So there are some other issues there. We have looked at that in the past and have not found it a satisfactory solution for our needs.
Thanks, Max. I will have to pause it, but I want to give Adele a chance to comment. Could you maybe sum it up in 30 seconds? That'd be great.
I was just going to say quickly that I was for using pound dogs as well, because I know how many thousands are put down every year, and it's such a waste. It is such a waste. But after looking at all the research that has been done and all the alternatives, there's such a great reason to use ethically sourced cadavers. I mean, apart from what Si's already said, and she can say more about it, there's also a clinical history with them, and students don't get desensitized to the fact that they're using greyhounds. What's the difference between using greyhounds and pound animals? But they've got a clinical history with them, and there's different pathological conditions that we can learn about. So the fact that Max has said that it hasn't worked in the past, Tufts is using it. They've done it for 10 years. We can make it work. We just have to use the right procedures and schedules to get this to work properly. If we can do it, if they can do it, we can do it.
Thanks very much, Adele. Did you want to say that? Okay. Okay, so that just, Roseanne's made a couple of practical points about different jurisdictions and local laws and policies and how that can influence supply as well. If we could just pause for a couple of minutes, those who need to leave, thank you very much for coming along, and we'll continue again shortly. Thank you very much to all of those who've been able to stay. Oh, sorry. Oh, sorry.
okay? And basically what you're going to do is make an incision in that. As you make that incision, you then get to expose the intestinal tract, the bladder, and the genital tract. And you can operate on that, remove the genital tract, and then another one can be put in for the next student in the queue to sort of do that. So that's the sort of concept that we've been working on. Financial viability of this stuff is still sort of up in the air. It's about $30 for each replacement tract, but this sort of rather, in a way, if you like, crude-looking dog abdomen costs about $1,250 each. So it's not a cheap undertaking to do this sort of work.
How many times can that be reused?
We don't know yet, but I'm hoping quite a few times, quite frankly. It has to be able to make it in any way justifiable.
Would the vet school supply those, or would the students?
That is the plan. We have got a group of these that we've had funded from the Vet Science Foundation. They've funded the purchase of these and the development of the model and the purchase of these and a couple of hundred general tracks. That's what we have at the moment.
Thanks very much, Max. Any more questions from the floor? Maglan.
Yeah. I just wanted to say something. I think there's a bit of a misconception. I mean, we work at the RSPCA, so we know firsthand about pound dogs. There's a misconception that animals that are put to sleep are actually put to sleep that are healthy. And in fact, for the RSPCA, and especially in areas like Sydney and where there's big cities, the animals or the dogs that are put to sleep, very, very few of them are put to sleep for lack of space. They're usually put to sleep for medical reasons or behavioural reasons. So I just want to just, you know, let you know that that's actually the reality of it. Cats are a different story. Obviously, a lot of the cats come in are semi-owned, feral cats, and a lot of them can't be rehomed. But what we try and do as the RSPCA is we try and make sure that through education and programs like CAWS, where we're actually desexing animals that otherwise wouldn't be desexed because of financial constraints, those programs, as well as moving animals across the state, because as you know, in regional areas, pound animals, there's probably almost 100% euthanasia rate for dogs in those areas, purely because there's not the population of people to take on those animals as pets. So what we're trying to do in regional areas is actually move those animals from those areas to areas where there are people that there are good homes for those animals that are actually suitable for rehoming, because not all animals are suitable for rehoming, and we know that firsthand.
Okay, thanks very much, Madeline. And just to summarise, spoke from the point of view of someone involved in managing pound animals, pointing out that dogs generally euthanized not because of they just can't be rehomed.
In your experience,
medical or behavioural reasons, yes, rather than just a sheer surplus of numbers. A bit more complicated with cats, but also regional differences where there's more animals than people.
And we've published papers on that too, in terms of the regional differences, where we've been doing CAWS for many years now.
Thanks.
And the other thing that I wanted to comment earlier was the animal handling. And I think if you flip side it and you actually you think about the perspective of the animal and how it's handled by an inexperienced person, there is actually a welfare issue there as well. Now, we've been involved as the RSPCA in training and assessing the students at Sydney Uni for a few years now in animal handling. And one of the things that we identified over the years was that due to the differences in the students that are coming through, obviously a lot of them, like Peter was saying, haven't had that hands-on experience. It is noticeable, and from an animal welfare point of view, that's actually an issue. Not even, you know, by the time they graduate, we expect them on for day one to be able to handle the animals. And if you don't handle them well and you're not competent and you're not confident, not only is there the issue of the welfare of that particular animal, but there's the occupational health and safety issue, which as an employer is a huge issue as well.
Thanks, Marianne. And that's been brought out in some of the other presentations as well, both the animal welfare and the occupational health and safety aspects of good animal handling skills. Thank you, next.
Actually, just build on that. Their research been done, and I don't know how the admissions works here, on whether experience before coming into vet school has made a difference, and if that would be something that you could implement to get more comfortable with animals so that we can eliminate the welfare of doing that while in school.
So So you're talking about experience of the animals?
Yeah, just as...
So can animals be selected on the basis of their previous experience so that they might be more amenable to training?
Right. So, for instance, I worked as a vet nurse before coming into vet school for a couple of number of years, and I had tremendous experience doing that. And I find that sometimes here we don't, a lot of students don't necessarily have that background, and whether that would be a good marker for admissions, for instance.
Okay, so you talk about experience of the students as well as the exposure to the young.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. What do you want to comment on that?
We've often thought that students should have evidence of animal handling prior to coming in and doing a degree like veterinary science. So it's one of the arguments for it being a postgraduate degree that they've had the opportunity to develop sufficient animal handling skills so that we don't have to spend so much of our effort in teaching them to get to that. But now one of the issues that we've got, especially in the livestock area, is that the benchmark has been raised. As new graduates from Sydney University, you're compared with Charles Sturt graduates, and they select people on their animal handling abilities before they go into the degree. And the feedback we're getting is, it's not published evidence yet, but it will be, is that Charles Sturt University graduates are preferred by rural practices because they are proficient in the cattle yards and the sheep, and they understand everything about livestock. They selected them. Now, we've got the benchmarks being raised. We've got a credibility issue. We really need to put more effort into getting our students up to speed by the time they graduate with a veterinary degree, if they want to work in rural areas, to be able to compete. Now, fortunately, there are many other graduate attributes that our practitioners like searching skills, communication skills, and things like that. But the weakness consistently across the board that comes back to us is senior students' animal handling is substandard in the livestock area, and we put a lot of effort into trying to improve it.
I just would like to make ask a question or comment on that. I mean, it seems to me that we know that students will be pursuing careers in particular areas, and is there not a? It seems to me. I've just got visions of some of my watching how people used to try and muscle down horses and cattle. When you're small, you actually have to learn how to do it properly. But one of the things about that is it not a question of, dare I say it, horses for courses? Do we actually need to have all students competent for managing all animals, or do we actually not need to say that there are needs to be special courses that relate to what may be their future career? And that to me, that's also got the benefit of having those who actually perceive that as their professional goal, focusing on the being handling animals and doing those sorts of those issues, with the various procedures, and not necessarily subjecting animals to a whole raft of students who actually will never do that. I mean, as a refinement, it seems to me quite a sensible way of approaching it.
Thanks very much, Margaret. Greg, would you like to comment on that? I know you make two comments.
I haven't had much to say. First of all, just following up on Peter, in speaking to farmers, so I'm not talking about vets in terms of practitioners, I'm talking about farmers. They have told me how poor our vet students are in handling livestock on farms. So there's an issue there. It's not just in the practice, it's seen during the professional experience while the students are in the learning phase. And the second issue was, which was the point. Oh, yeah, building on competency, and that's what I was talking about when I had my little 2 seconds worth. We start off with introducing students to the different livestock species, and that's really where my area is, and then showing them this is what an animal is, this is what a pig is, a chicken is, and this is how you interact with it, and this is how you handle it. And that's the basic level, and you build on that going through the course, and towards the end, as the student decides, well, I want to work with poultry, I want to work with this, then you start to build those skills, and you develop that better and better through work experience in, say, the piggery or the poultry unit or wherever, also in the professional experience area.
So you're really agreeing with Margaret that perhaps there could be some streaming of students, so you're not trying to produce graduates who are globally competent across all the species in terms of animal handling.
Yeah, I think that's very difficult. I think some people have that capability, but not many. But yeah, I would prefer to see that everybody gets a little bit to start with. And the point's been raised earlier that most of the students that start these two degrees are actually not from farming backgrounds. They're actually from the city, and they've probably never seen an animal other than maybe a cat or a dog.
Yes.
I think that's an interesting idea. So you're thinking of maybe starting 2 or 3 years and then they branch off or something into streaming off into different areas. Well, how would you feel as academics if you get a group of students and they say, okay, who's going into the production animal section, and no one puts their hands up? What will you do?
Well, it's favoured for those who've worked in America because that's where they do it. But the accreditation requirements of our veterinary degree is that our students have to be omnicompetent across all species in the current accreditation of Australia. And if you want to work in the UK and EU, that's the same issue. You've got to be omnicompetent at graduation. And that's not an issue because if you go that way, but if you want to go to Western New South Wales and you're employed in a practice with a Charles Sturt graduate, you're up against it, because they're going to be a lot better than you if you haven't really taken the message that we try to give you in first and second year, that you've got to develop the animal handling skills up to a level of competency by the time you graduate, so that you can work safely and really understand farm management. We can't do it. We've got limited time in the degree to do this. And if you want to work in the rural area, you've really got to pick up the skills yourself. Or ring up the manager at Arthur's and say, can I come out and go for shearing this year? Or can I spend the summer holidays working with you? Or, you know, spend time on farms. You've got to do it if you want to work in the livestock area now in New South Wales and really pick those skills up, unless you come from a rural background. And, well, we've got 15 of the new intake, 15%, I believe, of the new intake, which does include some rural entry students and and Curry and other programs. It's only still the rural entry scheme tries to fix it, but it won't solve the problem. It's only going to give us a small cohort of rural kids who hopefully will enable co-learning. But yeah.
Thanks, Peter. Sorry, just I know you've been trying for a while to ask a question.
I think we're a bit stuck here. I've just been noticing, I mean, I've learnt something from every presentation, and I think it's been a fantastic panel. And I think part of why we might be stuck on animal handling, yes or no, pound dogs, yes or no, is because the speakers have covered quite a broad range of issues, but I have been picking up in some of the questions and from some of the speakers that there's almost an assumption that if people are questioning the use of animals in teaching, that those people are saying, well, we should not have any use of animals in teaching, so no animal handling or no livestock handling. And I actually haven't heard anybody on the panel say that we don't think there should be animal handling taught. What I'm hearing from them is learning animal handling in a way that is in the best interests of the animal. So starting off, say, with a video presentation doesn't mean that you're always going to be handling a cat through a video presentation. It's an initial orientation to some of the practices. The other comment I'd like to make is about the farming, managing production animals, learning to handle them. We haven't addressed the fact that farmers are not the best animal handlers necessarily. They may be the best at doing procedures they've been doing for many years, but we're coming to this not as future farmers, we're coming to this as future vets. And I think we do have a lot to offer. I think we have things to teach farmers about how to handle animals and how to perform procedures in more humane ways. And that's something I would like to hear spoken of a little bit more.
I think that I'll just reiterate particularly your last point.
Yeah.
I suppose your first point really is that you're implying that perhaps there's room for both. For
yeah,
the
I don't
videos,
think...
the models,
yeah,
and some live animal handling.
Yeah.
But also particularly, if we compare ourselves to farmers, we're not trying to reduce farmers generally, although some animal science graduates will undoubtedly take that career path, but we are in fact going to be providing evidence-based advice to the farming community.
Such as analgesia, the use of analgesia and dehorning, etc. I mean, my experience on the vet faculty here was very much you just do what's been done for generations in industry, and you don't question that. And that's something...
Would all the panel agree that there is room for both? And I suppose I'm looking particularly at Cy and Adele and Catherine. You know, my experience in teaching, as Margaret said right at the beginning, different people learn in different ways. Do you agree that there is a scope for some use of animals?
I'm not about not using animals. I mean, we have to touch animals during our vet degree. Mm. Otherwise, what's the point of becoming vets? Mm. But the way I look at it is that the way it's done isn't very good at the moment. Basically, with looking at the surgery side of things, if we can master our basic manual skills right from year one, like suturing, instrument handling, knot tying, that sort of thing, using plastic organs and similar models, and then we can progress to things like simulated surgery on ethically sourced cadavers, you know, then we would have some skills before we get to that stage. And then finally, when we get to the point where, for example, at Camden, where we actually are doing the desexing on pound animals, that means we're progressing at a proper rate and a proper staging where we get to the point where we are using live animals, but we get the whole procedure from physical exam before they go under anaesthetic, then we get the anaesthetic, the surgery, and then we get the post-op procedures and making sure that they go home and they're comfortable. And that's the way it should be done. So it's not a case of I don't believe we should be using animals at all. Of course we need to, but it's got to be done in the right way.
Thanks very much, Adele. Oh, sorry, come on. Yeah, you've done pretty well.
Can I just quickly mention one thing?
You've got 15 seconds.
Just to mention, the desexing facility which was introduced into the University of Sydney was actually a result of trying to find ethical alternatives. So, you know, that managed to increase our skill level, I think, quite substantially. So, that involves animal handling, but it's an ethical alternative.
Thanks very much, Cy. Look, I'd like to continue, but I just feel we've sort of gone 20 minutes over time, and I think in fairness to the panel who've given up their time, we should wrap it up. Two points I would make, I suppose. I think if nothing else, we'll come away from this afternoon realising the issue is much more complex, that it's got many areas which, to varying degrees, are interconnected with each other. I'd like to thank you all on the panel very much for coming up, for giving your time, and for your very frank and open expression of your views. So thank you all. And that concludes this year's Robert Dixon Memorial Symposium. Thank you all for coming along.